distinguished audience and friends, as I shared with you yesterday, we have inappropriate way of expressing battery of, you know, distinguished personalities amongst us, beginning from, if I begin from my left, Dr. Alka Pande, Rubina Karore, Anju Dodiya, Bhavna Kakkad, Navina Sundaram, Atul Dodiya, Mithu Sen, Dr. Goswami, Sadanand Menon, Tasneem Mehta, and maybe somebody sitting, there was Nanak Ganguly, he's hiding somewhere. You can imagine what is going to happen in the question answer session, as we had, you know, some very, very pertinent questions from Sadanand and Atul Dodiya, and after that from Nanak Ganguly. We'll begin this evening with Anju Dodiya, then after that Sadanand Menon. After that they'll share a dialogue between themselves and the audience.
I'd like to thank you, Mr. Manna, for inviting me to be here. I think I'll start by telling you a little about myself, and generally there is, I have this reputation of painting self-images, and that's all I tend to hear, but I do use a self-image, and that's really a lie, because I work with a fictional self-image, and I try to make stories which are not necessarily about myself, but they involve all of us. It's about all of us. And I would say that my main content really is fear and doubt and the whole process of anxiety in life, you know, it's about that. And I started with what I've got here today is work from almost 91 to 2012, and I'll start with the first image. I went to the JJ School of Art, and all my 5 years there I studied in this very academic school, but I was doing collages, so I did this at the age of, I was 17, and constantly I was kind of collecting paper and working with images and putting them together, and it was very abstract. That was what the school was about, and that was what interested me. And in a very strange way, I finished art school and I had this strange need to paint the figure. And I must tell you that I think most of my art, it comes from this whole thing about intuition and impulse, and it's about compulsion. So everything that I do comes out of a very definite need. So it's not that I'm working with strategy, or I'm working with, you know, it has to be like this, only because I need to do that that point of time. So in a very strange, terrible way, I leave this school which was attempting to teach me the figure. I leave it, and then I want to draw the figure. While I was there, I'm doing these abstract collages. I have this one from the very first year. So I left art school and I needed to draw the figure. So I struggled on my own, and what was very much a part of my side activity at that time, which was like I would maintain a nocturnal diary of drawing myself. So that nocturnal diary became like a kind of a source book, like something to work with, that this is what I may use, something that I may explore as figure, as body, as what I am all about. And those drawings became what I started out with. So it was basically, I did a lot of work in, this is from 90, that was my first exhibition, and they were small size watercolors, and it was about a girl in a room. And it was not a girl in a room, really, it was an artist in a room. So image after image, I started with this whole, the whole creative baggage of being anxious about what one paints and what is one going to do out there, became my content. And in a sense, it was, as an artist, it was the artist's anxiety that what am I going to paint? And at the same time, I think it was about, on some human level, about, you know, that when I'm here at this moment, what am I going to do? What is it about the next moment? And that being on edge. So that being on edge was, I think, very important. It was an important trigger for my work. And I will run through my images and you will see that it's constantly about that, that tension. And the medium, you know, that the choice of watercolor, it also had that, it also carried, the tension was inherent. Because with watercolor, you put a mark and it doesn't go away. So, you know, it appears very spontaneous that you're working with water and you're doing what you want to do. But every time with watercolor, when you put a mark, it will not go away. So it's very, very definite. And the process will, you know, it has an inherent tension and anxiety about it, which I think went very well with the kind of work I do and the kind of person I am. So this is Monday morning. So I'm going to run through these, the early paintings. They're small size watercolors and the artist in the room, so to say. This is Lida, which is about, actually it's about, I think, again, being on the edge of adulthood and, you know, innocence and adulthood and this whole thing about, I think it comes from Lida, the myth of Lida and this woman being kidnapped by Jupiter and taken over, but it's also about being on the edge of sexuality and the edge of knowing and not knowing. I painted a head like Salome because I was a painter of heads. So that. I was constantly looking for kind of, I would say, images that would come to me as they were like props to say what I wanted to say. So it's like the birds, the orioles are from a Mughal miniature. And, you know, I was really thinking about the two selves, where one is the artist self in control and the other is the, you know, that undefined self which needs to be expressed and is almost levitating when it is allowed to. Called Storm of the Indigo Pillow, and slowly I started working larger, but basically I think it was about the double self and again having conversations with oneself. It got more and more dramatic for me, so it was as if I was putting up a kind of theater where one expressed private thoughts which you know, confronting yourself in the mirror, asking yourself about, it's about self-doubt, really. And constantly, you know, as if, you know, exposing your vulnerable self and being afraid. Also, I refer to the violence of the creative process again and again, and this comes from the myth of Athena. You know, she was kind of dragged out of Jupiter's head. So that thing about, you know, the same as a creative person, you're constantly pulling out images out of your head. So it's violent, you know, it's tough on every creative person, and I often speak about that in my work. Studio Guest is, it's a takeoff from a 19th century Dutch painting and European artist painting in India, and really it was an image of sword swallowers entertaining two European ladies, but I saw that image and I kind of identified with it so much that you know, constantly we are doing this, the artist as performer, you have guests in the studio, you have foreign curators visiting, and this is what one does, you know, it's about that small vulnerable self being exposed and having to perform again and again. Paper Eater. It's, I think at this point I should mention that the structure of this comes from the Japanese ukiyo-e prints, and I have always been interested in them, and I love the tension, you know, in a ukiyo-e print, in the sense that the linearity and the elegance is saying something, and but often the subject matter, you know, there is extreme sex and there's violence, and so that is doing something else. So the two things working together interest me very much. I am interested in the dual nature of things. This is it's a takeoff from a film still. This is The Passion of Joan of Arc. It's a film of George Dreyer and Carl Dreyer, sorry. And I have always been interested in European cinema, especially not the very new, but also the French avant-garde, and the idea of the close-up and the idea of drama in within a kind of frame that interests me very much. And I think I have learnt a lot from, I would say, especially the cinema of Bergman. Rose Fever. Lovers is, she's almost strangling him, and the size of this painting is 6 feet across, and it's called Triumph of the Erasers. And I was thinking about this whole thing about, you know, she's in this elaborate costume, and the paper is bare, and there's an erasure there, and I think erasers are really extremely, they're taunting devices, you know, for an artist. Every time you pick up a pencil, there is going to be an eraser next to you taunting you that, that does one really make anything of value? You know, when you think of, say, Rembrandt and Picasso and, you know, masters around me, and you know, you feel, is it worth it? Am I making anything that is important? Should I just pack my bags and leave? So so I've been making art, I think, consistently, again and again, about not having to say enough, or it's like you could say a fear of failure and a fear of not having enough to express, you know, and I'm expressing it consistently and aggressively, and enjoying it. This is watercolorist. Again, it's 7 feet high. It's also basically the nature of watercolor is not, you know, to work large, and it is a difficult medium, but. I think gradually I've been enjoying this. It gives me a sense of unpredictability, the way water performs, you know, on a large size. And it's very good, the unpredictability. It keeps you on your toes and it's alert to the image. I was thinking of Tarkovsky's Bell Makers in Andrei Rublev. And I did this painting as the show was called Icon of the Millennium, and it's kind of a tribute to those bell makers. It's also kind of a thinking about slowness and that time when a bell mattered. How does a bell matter now? It doesn't matter, and we're in this whole rush, and you know, it's about being there first, hearing it faster and quicker, and it depresses me, the whole speed of life. It's called Dance, and this is 4 feet by 6 feet. Cocoon, and the costume comes from a Chinese fashion design that I had seen, and I have been using fashion a lot, on and off. And when I say fashion, I mean I feel that the idea of the garment, and often the way designers work, contemporary in the 30s, 50s, Japanese design, you know, there's someone called Rei Kawakubo, And it's amazing the way you see the body take on distortions because of fashion. And it interests me as an emotional element that fashion, I don't mean fashion as style, but fashion as an expressive element where the body is distorted and it starts saying something. And I use that a lot in my work. Phantoms. I'm just giving you the titles, it's kind of sharing and... It's called Empire of Sleep. It's called Rain, and again, I was really speaking about the whole pressure, the whole anxiety of the creative process. This painting is from, the image is from a film still. It had Kanan Devi, I think, in it. I don't remember the name of the film, but I like this idea of this dressed up persona and the very alert self pouncing on the balls, and each ball had this image of the self, and it's about the extreme concentration, which is very much part of one's work. Convoy. That head coming out of the sleeve, it comes from, I was in Japan and I'd seen this very tiny sculpture of the birth of Buddha. And it seems we've heard all kinds of stories about Buddha being born under the tree. And here in this depiction, I saw that he's born out of his mother's sleeve, which I thought was fascinating and it as an image. And also this whole idea of vagina as sleeve, and it interested me. All these paintings are mostly 4 feet by 6 feet. Pillory is it's a medieval device which I love medieval painting and pre-Renaissance painting and Giotto and it's also about all these medieval punishment devices are really extremely violent and sometimes funny, and I just put myself there because that's the feeling one gets, you know, that whole sense of exposure. And every time you put an image out and it's about you know, kind of throwing your chest open to the world and being in a public square, so to say. So this painting is about that. You know, I've been told, and it interests me that in my work, you know, I sometimes put together two or three images from different areas, and it's like a tarot card, you know, in the sense that there are one or two dramatic things happening, and you're not quite sure what it's saying or where it's taking you, and so this particular image is taken directly from a tarot card, and I thought, why not use the same logic? Bequest. This is, I've done a series of works which actually, they are all images of Shiva, so to say. And we were in Haridwar and I was responding to the city, and I was quite fascinated by all these the fakirs with the fantastic hairstyles, you know, these buns going around them. And so I thought, why not Shiva, the ultimate fakir? And so all these paintings are, I did a lot of them at that time. This is, it's called Spaghetti Shiva, and that you see Ganga coming out of his hair, and of course she's holding a pencil because she comes from my studio. So I like the third eye of Shiva very much, which This was a mural which I did. It's actually a mattress painting. So there are two mattresses there, you see, and it's about the marriage of Shiva Parvati. And I was invited to do this, and it was a 14 feet space, and for me that was huge as a watercolorist and working on paper. So I started with the idea of that I would do drawings on paper, you know, fill up the whole space, and then later I said maybe not paper and maybe fabric. So I started with the idea of doing drawings on fabric, and then because it was the Shiva Parvati marriage, I said why not draw on a bed. So so finally this work happened, and it was a double mattress with the Shiva and the Parvati. The Parvati is a Japanese Parvati, because I thought that why not Mount Kailash and Mount Fiji? It's a cosmic marriage, so why not? And that's how it happened, you know, that I painted my first mattress. And what you see, those metal cutouts on top are the guests at Shiva's wedding. So after doing the mattress painting, I was quite I loved the feel of paint on fabric, and I thought it's a great idea, the mattress being a very it's a painting, but it becomes a sculpture by default. So I thought I'm going to push this further, and soon after I did this painting, which is called Circus of Insomnia, and also the kind of themes I work with, you know, the anxiety and yeah, basically sleepless nights because you're an artist. So stuff like that, I thought could be part of my work on a mattress. Yeah, also lovers which come again and again. So that also would work. And this is about it's 4.5 feet by about 6.5. It's Cloud Hunt, and it's about really. Of course, the image comes from a Japanese ukiyo-e print, and but when I say the image, I mean the female figure. And the show was called Cloud Hunt because I was interested in the body and the mind, and but also about this kind of very abstract search that all of us are into, you know, at some point. It's about you want something, you don't know what, and it's abstract and it's beautiful, and it's also very, you will never grasp it, you know, it comes and goes. It's like clouds, so that's a cloud hunter. It's called Island of Greed, and I was thinking about, you know, I think allow all kinds of ideas to come in, and it's also, my art is about celebrating the insignificant. So it's mine, and it's my thought, or it's my game, and I'm doing it because I need to, or I want to, and I may create beauty, or I may create a puzzle, but I need to make that poetry. So it's very important for me, and because it is intense and honest, I trust that it will make a connection with the viewer. And so it's about these things. So it's I don't think I've ever painted directly political content, or it's not that one is not sensitive to one's times, one is, but I think I connect in different ways, in small ways, or sometimes the sense of drama, which the emotional theater that I will spot in a moment may not be necessarily the moment of the century, you know, it may not be significant, but I believe in that, because, and also there have been painters before me. You know, I think of painters who stuck with their small space, their small worlds, and produced work of value. So I think I need to follow this path. So anyway, Island of Greed is about that whole, you know, this greed that I have, maybe all of us do, for images, for knowledge, for information, you know, and now with Google, it's nonsense, though, you know, how far we'll go. Just digging and digging and knowing and wanting, and where does it stop? You know, it's this is called Sight, and it's actually about, it's like the mocking of Christ, you know. So it's set up like that, the self-image. And I have often used the a self-mocking aspect in my work as I think it gives you a great sense of distance to look at yourself in a different way. You allow yourself to be made fun of. This Daphne is, it was my idea of a contemporary Daphne in the sense that the figure that you see was inspired by, it was a 30s underwear ad, you know, this lady standing in a slip, and her gesture I thought was a lot like all the Daphne paintings in the museums, the Renaissance paintings and the sculptures, and you know, she's throwing her hands up as if she's going to turn into a tree any moment and escape from her, was it Jupiter? Yeah, okay, maybe I got it wrong. Apollo, sorry. Yeah, so, yes, Apollo. So, I was interested in the lady and her posture, and then it reminded me of Daphne, so that's how she became Daphne, and I thought, as a contemporary woman, you're not really escaping suitors. It's also about escaping the mundane, you know, this everyday situation, which you don't want to live with. So it's like the labyrinth of the commonplace. And Daphne is trying to fly off. Okay, this is a kind of almost a small series of paintings which I did. This is a small work. It's imperial size, 30 inches. And it's a series of heads with hats which I painted. And that happened because I read that, I mean, of course, as a visual element and this as a painter of faces, it adds a prop to work with. But apart from that, you know, I read that hat makers in the 18th century, they would have these, they would make hats with felts and chemicals and things, so they would suffer these symptoms of, you know, shivering hands and a certain nervousness. And I thought that they were absolutely the painter's symptoms, you know, this is what I go through. So I kind of connected, and that connection made me, you know, feel that it was right to paint hats in spite of living in tropical Mumbai. This is, I collect for my own work. I have often, I mean, of course, I look at all kinds of art and cinema and images come into my work, but I also collect a lot of newspaper cuttings, and I have this whole pile of mourners, and it's partly having looked at the paintings of Roger van der Weyden, and you know, there is something about pain and the depiction of pain, you know, when it, which interests me as also, actually, it's difficult to say. We'll come to that. This is again, it's part of the mourners, but actually, it comes from a newspaper photo of Maria Sharapova. And, you know, I have often collected these sports pictures where, you know, when you see them, these sports stars at moments of, you know, anguish or great joy when they win or lose and stuff like that, because in real life, every day, you and me, you know, we are such controlled, civilized people, and we don't say what's on our minds, we don't express, and it's very polite behavior where one misses out on looking at these dramatic excesses. So sports star, you know, they allow this, you know, so I enjoy that a lot, and I collect images and let them into my art, and this whole thing about expressing and saying. It's called Between the Eyes. I think charcoal entered my work. Actually, your introduction said it all, but I'm going to repeat myself. And the charcoal it came into my work as a kind of, I thought watercolor was getting, I was getting into the habit of watercolor, and it was becoming easy. And also, there was a certain beauty and a transparency and elegance to the medium, inherent in the medium, which I needed to fight. And I found that charcoal helped me a lot, as you know, as the way the dust functions, as it kind of pollutes, and it the way it sticks to your hands, and the power of the line, and as against the delicacy of the stain. So all these things, I think, were very important to me. I did a series of paintings on textile, and this is acrylic on fabric. It was kind of corrugated, the fabric itself, and the image is really, it comes from a it comes from a newspaper photo. I don't want to talk about it, but basically, actually, I was talking about communication gap, and you know, the whole the circuit of sharing and not sharing. Again, it's on acrylic on fabric. It's about 4 feet by 6 feet, and it refers to the myth of Penelope for me. And that's I have a skin disorder by which when I was I had these white patches, which were my brown skin is slowly turning white, and so I kind of connected it with the myth of Penelope, where she spends these years waiting for her husband to come, and she's weaving throughout. And I felt that, okay, so my skin is brown, it's turning white, and then from white maybe it'll turn brown, I don't know. So I connected the sense of skin with this idea of waiting, and the idea of waiting made me think of Penelope. And it's rather, maybe it's rather excessive or weird for someone else, but I think this is what I'm always looking for. I'm looking for a trigger to make me want to create a surface, to create an image. And the triggers are exciting. That's what one lives for, really. This is again a takeoff from the Penelope myth, and this idea of weaving, you know, this woman weaves day and night, she weaves through the night, and she kind of opens it out in the day, and just because she doesn't want it to be complete. And so this bird image, I think I'd seen it was a Persian miniature, and the way the wings were structured, I thought it's just like a woven element. And I painted it thinking of Penelope and her day's labor being done and undone and done and undone, and that whole cycle of life that she lived, just because, you know, you don't want something to happen or you want it to happen, and it's so absurd. And at the same time, there's a beautiful rhythm to it. So the painting is called Path of Berries. This was a series of works, it was called Secret Garden, and had things growing out of your head, out of my head, like thoughts. This was 2007, and this installation was called Throne of Frost, and I did it in the Baroda Palace in the Darbar Hall. And I was invited to work here because I was doing these mattresses, which my gallery thought would look good in the space, because it was ornate and it was beautiful and grand, and somehow, you know, the association of color and fabric seemed to connect with the space. And so when I was invited, I was taken aback as a painter, because one works with walls and against walls, and here this place had no walls. It had just jarokhas and design and more design, and 10 chandeliers, and it was just too much to handle. So my solution to this whole problem was I did these 30 paintings going around the hall, the Darbar Hall, which is about 60 feet by 25 feet. And I put a lake of mirrors in the middle, which would reflect the ceiling, which was like grand, and connect the whole space. And because otherwise, the moment you enter the space, you look at the ceiling, which is, you know, so one wanted to take away from it. And at the same time, how much can you take away from a grand palace? So I decided to keep my mode, my formal mode, simple. So I decided to do black and white drawings, which did not stay so much black and white. And there's a mattress back to the paintings. So when you enter, you see these the mattresses, which are colorful and bright with embroidered motifs on them. And you see the paintings later, which are looking in. So the whole, I kind of created this rectangle with mirror shards in between and the paintings going around it. So that was my solution to the space. And Throne of Frost was really, it was like, it was a meditation on, I would say, wealth and transcendence and death and the whole transitory nature of things and life. So the paintings were of different sizes, you know, to kind of create a kind of chain where you can peer through and look at the paintings. But because you could not see them frontal, as you do in a regular gallery space, there was a immense tension, you know, you're kind of dying to, but you can't. And also, I'm aware that in our times, you know, it's a watercolor painting is a watercolor painting, you know, as if you know it all and you've seen it all. So if you put it in a gallery, there is a certain almost a resistance that, okay, I know this, now tell me more. So, but I found it was a wonderful game here, that because it was kept away from the viewer was kind of aching to go near it and see it and explore it. So this is what it was like, the mattresses with the embroidered motifs and then the paintings beyond. So you're on the edge of this lake of mirrors and trying to look in. And the motifs were like, sometimes they connected to the front and sometimes it was like a setting up a puzzle for the viewer. These images were from that show. So this is Changing Skin, charcoal and watercolor. This, for instance, this painting, it's called Victor because it looks like Victor Banerjee, the actor. And so this is the painting, and behind him on the mattress I had these scissors because he needed a haircut. So sometimes it was just, you know, funny and absurd like this. Sometimes it was more serious and thought about or secret. Or there were things like, for instance, the star and the crown you see behind, it comes from a soap, what do you call it, a branded soap design of early on. And so there were things mixed together which were sometimes regal and sometimes really popular culture, so to say. And no matter where the images came from, really I think I was interested more in the emotional state it created, you know, the whole, the temperature of the color, and I think that was important to me. So the image you see behind is from, it's in a Turkish harem, you know, so the slave in a Turkish harem, and in the front, the foreground, you see this woman cutting a cord, and on the reverse, you see this, it's from a medical illustration of William Harvey. So they're pointing to the arteries and, you know, in front you see that cutting. So somehow by association, there's a suggestion of violence. But it's very beautiful and, but somehow it becomes disturbing. This painting is called Opus and it's 8 feet high. And actually I was thinking about this thing about, you know, Francis Bacon has said that as an artist, what goes in, goes in. What comes out, you know, because he doesn't like to talk about his references or you know, whatever he's inspired by. It's too much of a story. It's boring, really. So, so I was just thinking about him that, you know, what goes in, and what comes out. It's like a musical score. So behind that painting, I had this, the going in and the coming out. Paper robe. This is Wajid Ali. This is called Love Gordon. It's 8 feet high. The maze of slowness. Slave with the pencil in her hand. This was, this head was 8 feet high. It was looking into the mirrors. It's called Shame of Greed. And it's a takeoff from a 19th century illustration, and this whole idea of wealth and being chained to it. Reference to the Baroda Maharani and her Louis Vuitton luggage. This was this was a defining painting for me. That the palace experience was about. You know, you don't know whether you've been embraced or you're being attacked. And the image comes from I think it's a Jangiri miniature. It's a drawing. It refers to that the hunt scene where the courtier is being pushed down by a lion. But anyway, that was the experience of working in the palace. You know, this image comes from that when you're looking for water, the water divining. It's I thought it must be a very spiritual experience, and at the same time, the whole the mystery of the process. It's like the creative process. You know, this constant hunting for images, and where does it come from, and where does it go? And sometimes you strike water, you know. So, it was at the, I was invited to, for a print residency, the Tyler Print Institute in Singapore. And I made this body of work, which, you know, that place, you can start making work with paper from the very pulp state. So you start with the paper pulp, and then you go on to build on it, tear it, make holes. Make screen print, etching, whatever. So it was a very fun experience. It was like being in a candy shop where you had all these things to do and you had a team helping you. So this was a different kind of experience. And what I've done is basically I worked with the white of the paper, and there are elements of text which come from the poetry of Sylvia Plath, which I connect with because of the way she is interested in structuring pain. So there was that connect. And then I took off from there, so this is the work. It says, I must make more maps, and the idea of heads overlapping again and again. So these are, they're prints, but it's 5 feet by about 6.5. And there are fabric elements which I inserted. And there are mirrors which were also inserted and installed on the paper. So they're reflecting, and also like a object, collage object. This was a triptych which runs across about 15 feet. six-season triptych. So this was called Heat Wave. Some of them are diptychs, where there's a fabric element with a screen print, and that's the other element where the sari is inserted into the pulp. It's a knotted sari that you see. This was this whole body of work. This new it was called Necklace of Echoes, and they were large watercolors which had things going around the neck. That was it. The story of Angulimal. This was a painting which a paper necklace for Sophie Kahl, and Sophie Kahl is a contemporary French artist, and she had done a work where she asked people to respond to a love letter which her lover sends her. It's a letter of rejection, and she wanted her friends to respond to it, or people like, say for instance, a school teacher might correct it for the grammar, or a lawyer might, you know, phrase a document against that letter, or, you know, things like that. So she had all kinds of people responding to that letter of rejection. And so I was thinking, if she had asked me, I would have made her a paper necklace out of the torn bits. You keep it and you lose it, both. Wall City. These were very small size watercolors, about 10 inches high. These were small, it's on wallpaper. This is a photographic installation. It's from last year, and I've been working like this, which is there is a photographic element, and there's an element where there is where I'm responding to my own work with stains, and the mount, which you see is a painted mount. So I'll just show you. I'll come closer so that you know what it's all about. The work is called Circuit of Erasures, and I'm referring to the whole connection of the images, and the picture on the left is taken from the family album, so to say, and it's a cropped image of myself, and the picture on the right is from my own work. It's stained, and it's about the memory of places you visited, or time past, or stain. It's also, I think I was trying to do this also because there's a certain minimal, innocent, the beauty of, you know, the purity of the first mark, which one forgets, you know, on the way. You become complex and you want to do more and add and talk about things. And so this whole idea of clearing the plate, so to say, was part of the intention of this work. It's also about somehow re-looking at yourself. As a person, as a body, as a face, as a photograph, and also your own work, you know, to return to it and do something to it and feel lighter and clearer. And this work is, in a sense, about the real self. And what I always do is fictional self. But I was surprised that the real self is actually, it's cool, and it doesn't seem to, as if, express the terror which the fictional self does. So they work in pairs, really. This body of work was called Face Off after Kuniyoshi, and again returning to the Japanese ukiyo-e prints, the 19th century master Kuniyoshi. He's specially done some strong samurai figures, and I have done and I keep doing a lot of studio pictures, kind of studio dramas, which involve the samurai body in the artist studio, and also expressing it as artist in the studio, and the whole the faith of the artist, the whole the obsessive nature of it, and this that do or die attitude which one lives with. So they're 4x6. Facing the demons. This is it's four panels. It's about 16 feet across, and there's one watercolor, one watercolor and mattress, and it's I did it for a private house, and I quite enjoyed that whole the combinations of the embroidery and the. This is a kind of tribute to Utamaro. Arachne. This beast is about the terror I was speaking about, this this terrible fear of the white and what it can do to you. And the image is taken from it's a Turkish miniature, and it's a takeoff from there. And I like the geometric mysteriousness of these beasts and how they're going to tear you apart. And this is what I did recently. It's called Room for Erasures, and there were three large drawings there and some ladders. And actually, I've been thinking a lot about this, like right now sharing with you again. It's reinforced that it's been a very linear process for me, and I've been on this singular path. And from the image number one to the last image you see, I'm constantly talking about the fear of being an artist, the terror. And so I often stand back, and at different times in my life I've stood back and thought whether it's a big farce and one needs to control this urge and do something else, but it never works. So in spite of a very genuine desire to, so I decided to make some large drawings, so that, you know, it's an effort, it's a significant struggle, and then maybe invite the viewer to come and erase this for me and help me start again. So it was almost like a ritualistic exercise that you can't do it yourself, so do it in some other way, so that you know, get some help. You can't do it yourself, get some help, and so the viewer helps me. So I devised this whole thing. It was like these were the drawings. They're 8x5 each, and pencil, and this was the eraser stand. It was designed like those, you know, like in the European churches, like a candle stand, like an altar, the whole thing was. And my viewers were invited to erase, and they did. It was enthusiastic, and sometimes it was, I got pained responses, all kinds of responses, and it spoke a lot. I think all over again, I was repeating a game, like in Throne of Frost, my viewer was kept away from the paintings, and here it was like, open, come and do what you like. And it was psychological. For me, it was about sharing, giving it away. And for the viewer, it was about how far will you go. And this is what post-erasure. it was ritualistic, because I think painting for me is like, it's like a martial art, and you know, it's about being controlled, and there's rigor, and there's power, and there's, you know, there are certain, you're absolutely committed to something. And so I thought that if there's going to be an erasure, let it be like that. So it was arranged, and it was formal, there was a ladder, and you know, it was available, and there were rules that you have to be an adult, and you're allowed to do anything, go as far as you want, and yeah, so lots of erasures. Okay. So. Thank you.
Thank you, Anju. What a quiet, you know, moment it was. It looks like a moment, in fact. You know, the inner fears, the inner doubts, predicaments, you know, the personal fears, they, when they become shared, you know, the, when they become others, the entire world comes within you, then you reach out to the world. The others' emotions are expressed through your personal experience, and then it becomes a shared kind of a bonding, kind of a feeling which everybody thinks is mine. You appropriate the other and give back to them wonderful experience.